Paul Revere was an artisan, businessman, and a patriot. Despite being a key part, he is often overlooked when considering the heroes of the American Revolution. Paul Revere, son of Apollos Revere and Deborah Hitchborn, was born in Boston's North End. Revere's father, Apollos, who immigrated from France, was a goldsmith who changed his name multiple times and eventually changed it to Paul Revere, which he later named his son. There is controversy concerning his actual date of birth, as there were two different calendars at the time. The old style calendar had Revere's date of baptism in late 1734. However, the new style calendar had him baptized either January 1st or 2nd. The overwhelming belief is that he was born in late December 1734, despite some sources claiming January 1st or 2nd as his birth date. Revere was educated at the North Riding School and learned the art of gold and silversmithing in his father's shop. When Revere was 19, his father died, leaving him as the family's main source of income. 2 years later, in 1756, Revere was commissioned as a second lieutenant in the Massachusetts Artillery and sent to fight the French in upstate New York. When he returned in the fall of 1756, he began to build the family silver business. Revere was responsible for both the workmanship and the quality of the metal alloy used. He employed numerous apprentices and journeymen. His shop produced pieces ranging from simple spoons to magnificent tea sets. His work was well regarded during his lifetime and is highly prized today. In August 1757, Revere married Sarah Orne, and together they had 8 children. Unfortunately, Sarah died shortly after the birth of their 8th child in 1773. Soon after Sarah's death, Revere married another woman named Rachel Walker and had 8 more children with her. In addition to being a talented silversmith, Revere had and needed many other professions and businesses due to an economic depression following the French and Indian War. Revere produced illustrations for books and magazines, business cards, political cartoons, book plates, a songbook, and bills of fare for taverns. He also worked as a copperplate engraver and practiced as a dentist, where he cleaned teeth, fastened false teeth, and sold toothpaste. There was a rumor that Revere made George Washington's false teeth, but there is no truth to that rumor. Not many people know how Revere got involved in politics and the American Revolution. He originally got involved with politics through connections with members of local organizations and business patrons. He also gathered intelligence on the British by watching the movements of the British soldiers. He was a courier for the Boston Committee of Correspondence and the Massachusetts Committee of Safety. He was hired as an express rider to carry news, messages, and copies of important documents as far away as New York and Philadelphia. He also participated in the planning and execution of the Boston Tea Party. He then spread word of the Tea Party to New York and Philadelphia. The event that made Paul Revere famous was his famous late night ride. Revere was given the task by Dr. Joseph Warren of Boston to ride to Lexington, Massachusetts, with the news that troops were about to move into the countryside northwest of Boston. According to Warren, the troops were planning to arrest Samuel Adams and John Hancock, and probably heading to the town of Concord to capture or destroy military stores, which had gunpowder, ammunition, and several cannons that had been stockpiled there. Revere was able to slip past a British warship in the darkness while trying to cross the river into Charlestown. He borrowed a horse from John Larkin, who was a Charlestown merchant and a patriot sympathizer. He then narrowly escaped capture just outside of Charlestown and changed his planned route and rode through Medford, where he alarmed Isaac Hall, the captain of a local militia. Revere then alarmed all the houses from Medford through Menotomy, while also avoiding Royal Mansion, home of well-known loyalist Isaac Royal. Revere finally arrived in Lexington sometime after midnight and approached the house where Hancock and Adams were staying. William Dawes arrived around the same time and delivered the same message as Revere upon arrival. Dawes and Revere verified that everything in the military stores had been dispersed and hidden. Just outside of Lexington, British patrol intercepted the men along with Dr. Samuel Prescott. Dawes and Prescott were able to escape, but Revere was captured. He was held for a while, questioned, and then released. However, he did lose the horse he borrowed, as it was reused to replace the tired mount of a British sergeant. He returned to Lexington on foot, in time to witness the last part of the battle on Lexington Green. Everything was not all positive with Paul Revere, however. He did face some controversy with his service in 1779 after the Penobscot Expedition. The Penobscot Expedition is a little-known event in Revolutionary War history. British were attracted to the Penobscot Peninsula because it could become a possible loyalist haven, a source of timber for the King's Navy, and a strategic naval base and coastal trading post. The British sent a small flotilla from Halifax, Nova Scotia, with around 750 troops to occupy the area and to build a fort, which would later be named Fort George. Maine was a province of Massachusetts at that time. The occupation of Penobscot and its potential as a British naval base was a great concern to the Massachusetts General Assembly in Boston. An American fleet of 19 armed vessels and 24 transports, with more than 1,000 ill-prepared militia, was assembled and sent to Penobscot Bay to retake the area under the command of Commodore Dudley Saltonstall, who commanded the naval forces, Brigadier General Solomon Lovell, who commanded the land forces, and Lieutenant Colonel Paul Revere, who commanded the ordnance train. Saltonstall turned his ships about and fled up the river, where his entire fleet of warships and transports were sunk or scuttled and burned by their own forces, to the surprise of both Lovell and Englishman Collier. The crew and troops, with most of their leaders, panicked and rushed to shore and into the forest, where they made their way back to Boston. Paul Revere was accused of cowardice and insubordination. He was extremely unhappy with the results of a board of inquiry, as they did not rule on his case in one way or another. Revere wanted a proper hearing, so he petitioned the Massachusetts government 7 times for a court-martial before one was finally convened in February of 1782. The court-martial ruled that Revere be found not guilty of all charges, and Revere accepted the result as vindication of his honor and returned to his business activities. After the war, Revere opened the first successful copper rolling mill in North America in 1801. He provided copper sheeting for the whole of USS Constitution when it was recoppered, and the dome of the new Massachusetts State House in 1802. In 1811, at the age of 76, Paul Revere retired and left his well-established copper business in the hands of his son Joseph Warren Revere and 2 of his grandsons. Revere passed away on May 10, 1818, at the age of 83, leaving 5 children, several grandchildren, and many great-grandchildren. Revere was not born into wealth, but did fairly well for himself and became a popular local figure. Although he may not get the recognition, Paul Revere did a lot for his country and is truly an American hero.